Okay, then what you see here, this is a metal bar. It has multiple materials that you can see. Multiple materials. A part of this is made up of stainless steel. Part of this is mild steel, aluminium, copper, stainless steel again of different make. Okay, aluminium again of different make and titanium. You see different materials are in a single piece, how it is made, how it is made. That is a process which is known as friction stir welding. Of course, this is not the topic of the day, but yes, this is an application of friction that we are going to study from now till next 5 classes at least. Okay, so what it does, it has a shaft. One shaft remains stationary, other one rotates on top of this at a very high speed. Okay. And friction is creating some heat energy dissipation over here. So with that heat, it gets fixed on top of this. Okay, so that is way, and then later it can be machined also. So another one is a similar example when you see two dissimilar metals are there and a piece keeps rolling on top of it at high speed and it moves. Okay. So those two pieces can be again joined like using friction stir welding. So this type of process is known as friction stir welding. This is very, very common nowadays, and it is still in research though, but it is one of the very good way to join dissimilar metals. So you see, friction has kept the world moving since long time, you know, is it not? Friction, due to friction only we all are moving. Do you agree with this? Yes. So it has kept all whole of the world kept moving with that. Now it is seeing a new dimension altogether, in at least in manufacturing. Okay, so you see, this is one of the method to join dissimilar method. There are many other noble things that are happening in industry, at least in manufacturing, when you see such applications that uses friction. Okay, so friction is not just a waste of something, you do plenty of useful things out of it also. So that is how our module is also designed. We won't go much in a chemical way or physical things that is causing friction, rather we'll see the effect of friction, we'll study that. Okay, so that we'll limit ourselves to physics of it, what it can be seen externally. Okay. So we'll see wedges problems. You have done a few before also during your JE days, joint entrance days. Screw jack, that is one of the biggest example when it is doing quite useful things. Okay, belt that is there, belt drives, axles and disc brake is there, axle friction is there in the bearing, journal bearings. So these are a few applications. We'll see how these machines work. Okay. So now moving ahead, we'll see what is there in your syllabus. Okay, so it says same. So this is what is your wedges. Wedges can create motion. If you push this inside, it can go upward. Okay, if you take it out, it can come downwards, right? So this is one example. You have another thing, screw jack. This is belt drives, pulley and drive. So altogether 5 classes. Plus one may be there for numericals and those things, but we'll go do things side by side. When we'll complete wedges, we'll do one numerical on that. When we'll do screw jack, we'll do another numerical on that. We'll keep doing side by side, apart from doing at the end also. Okay, so this is how we'll cover this altogether 6 classes. So that is how. So what exactly is friction? It is resisting force between the surfaces in relative motion. There has to be relative motion, okay, or impending to move also can create friction forces. Okay, not just they should be in motion, relative motion that has already started, it can tend to move, then also there is friction, you know that very well. So the surfaces can be of solid bodies in contact or fluid layers also. It is not just solid bodies can have friction, fluid layer by layer, if you know, it that also has friction, we'll see. Okay, so assumed, what we assume the relation, reason why it is there, it is mostly because of intermolecular forces. Okay, intermolecular forces, if the molecules are very close apart, there can be molecular forces that tend to attract the bodies and resist it from doing any relative motion. Okay, and any irregular surfaces, if they are in contact, there can be crest and trough on the bottom surface, there can be crest and trough on the top surface, and when they are both in motion, okay, so you need to jump on these hills and valleys, okay, and then only it can move. So this is one reason. Another one is due to intermolecular forces, okay, that doesn't allow this to move relative to this stationary one. So these are a few reasons that we assume, okay, that's an hypothesis, maybe it has proved later on. So anyway, so now assumptions, there are further assumptions while we'll do analysis of such situations. Forces of action and reaction, they act normal to the surfaces in contact. If you have a table, on the table you have a block, okay, so if it is, these are the two surfaces which are in contact, so the normal force is always directed perpendicular to this surface, the surface which is supporting this object. So this is one very big thing that we have assumed since the beginning only, cannot be there. If it is, it cannot be inclined like this, okay, it is always normal to the surface which supports the object itself. And it is valid only for smooth surface. For the time being, we are not assuming too much of roughness which is there on the surface, which is not smooth. Okay, so even with smoothest of a thing has some friction, then it comes quite clear that it is mainly because of intermolecular forces, okay, rather than irregularities on the surface. Okay, so smoothest of a thing also has friction, that means it is mainly because of intermolecular forces. They act in the direction opposite to the direction of relative motion, that you also know. So if this is moving like this, so friction force will try to keep in this direction, it will try to oppose the relative motion. Okay, so these are a few assumptions, and that is based on the things that we realize in day-to-day life. Okay, it is not a baseless assumption. Okay, so desired things that we are going to study, and they are desired for few things. Brakes, if friction is not there, brakes are not there. Clutches are devices that can isolate your running engine, running mechanism, running thing to isolate something which runs out of that. It can isolate that. So you have an engine, you have a differential gear that drives two of your back rear wheels in your car. So you have a clutch which is here that can decouple this from differential. So if this is your engine, okay, so this is your clutch. Clutch, as soon as you establish the contact, the rotating transmission that is happening, and that goes to the differential and finally to the wheels. Okay, so this is a clutch. It is also there in scooters and many other automobiles that you see. So that is a clutch. Belt is there. Belt is mills. Okay, flour mills, if you have been there. So these mills, you have a rotating shaft. This is your motor and this is your mill, okay, where you have another machine which can take in flour and it can do that. Okay, so that is a belt drive. These are belts. You should see a high amount of friction over here so that no slipping can happen. Okay, walking while you walk, it is because of friction you are moving forward. Okay, wheels, obviously you know, these two are few related things. Screws also, A screw which is tightened on a wood will slip and automatically come out if at all there is no friction. Is it not? So, screw also sees friction. So, these are a few where it is desired. There are places when it is not desired and it is unwillingly, it is there. As in case of a bearing, there are losses in the bearing. There is heat generated in the bearing. Okay. That is because of friction. And that is what we don't want. It is there in the gears also. If gears are meshing each other, they are, one is driving the other one, then also there are friction and it is not desired. Fluid flow, you have water which is flowing. So you see, if you have a canal, you have water like this, okay? You have water, so layer over layer. So the bottom one moves at the least speed, while the one which is on the surface moves with the maximum speed. Why? Because friction force is there in, yes, there is a drag force between any two layers, first layer, second layer, third layer, okay. So ultimately that is transmitted from the, because the bottom one is static, so the boundary layer which is sticking to this is hardly moving, then as it goes up it keeps moving at a faster pace. Okay, so that is fluid flow, that is also there. Sip and water, there is friction. That is why you need to push it continuously using propeller. Flight and air, rocket and its propulsion device. So, any many more where you want motion and it is getting a resistance because of friction. So, these are the places when it is not desired. So, results in wear, this results in wear, loss of energy. It can be dissipated as heat energy. Sometimes too much of it can cause even light sparks and all. Okay, so it is generation of heat, that is mostly the first thing that you see out of friction. Sometimes you want to generate heat because of friction. The application that you saw in the first slide, you wanted to generate heat energy so that you can melt two materials together and it can be welded together, okay, as in case of friction stir welding. So note, few notes are there. Ideal machine, friction is small enough and can be neglected. That is an ideal machine, which is not the real case. So real machine, friction must be taken into account, okay. So these are few introduction of friction. So let us move ahead and formally define few types of friction. One of them is dry friction, most commonly known as a Coulomb friction, that occurs between unlubricated exterior surfaces of any two rigid bodies if they are in contact and they are in relative motion. So most common one that we'll encounter, we'll study is this one. Okay. Another one is fluid friction, that occurs between adjacent layer of fluid, liquid or in gas state. They move at different velocities. Both are moving, but there exists a relative velocity. Then also there is friction. This is dealt mostly in fluid mechanics, and that is what we are not going to do here, okay, in this syllabus. Okay. Next is internal friction. Internal friction that resists the movement between particles of a material within the subsurfaces, within the surfaces of the material, contained within the material. So that is studied in material science. Again, this is not something of our concern now. In this syllabus, we won't be doing that. We'll be only sticking to this. Okay. So now, some mechanism of dry friction, that is Coulomb friction. Okay, we'll call it simply friction from now on, not even a dry friction or Coulomb friction. Okay, so with no external force, weight of this cube which is on top of the surface on which it is sliding, or even if it is stationary, so this is causing a normal reaction. And you know, now we have assumed already that normal reaction will always be perpendicular to this surface. And because they are in equilibrium, okay, they are in equilibrium. So, whatever weight that comes downward on this surface, same amount of normal reaction is acted on the block itself or the object which is on which is getting support by this table or surface. Okay, so both are always equal. Okay, and not just equal, if you go further, you should know they should be collinear. It should not happen something like this. What this can cause, if n is like this, yes, it will create a torque. Yes, it will create a rotary motion. So that is also not there. So that means both should be in a straight line. Okay, so that is one thing you should know. And then as p increases, p is what? P is an external force that is acting from the side of it and trying to move this block. Okay, so this force, as it increases, the frictional force comes into play. Okay, so F increases. F is what? This is the between two surfaces. Okay, that is acting. So that is frictional force. So this is again balanced with this, as long as it is not, it has not started moving. If it is not moving, again this force should be equal to this force. Okay. You gradually increase at a time, at a particular time, what will happen? A threshold will come and this block starts moving with some velocity. Okay. In that case, definitely P becomes more than F. Okay. Again, if it is moving with a velocity, with a velocity it is not accelerating, okay, that means again friction force is equal to P. Type of friction force will change, that we'll see. But yes, as long as it is in stationary, it is stationary or it is moving with a uniform velocity, F is equal to P. Done. So until unless it reaches its maximum value, that is the threshold, beyond which there will be relative motion that starts happening. Till that threshold value, that maximum value is called static friction. You know that already. So that is given by F is equal to mu s times n. What is this now? Okay, frictional force is seen, it is proportional to normal reaction. Normal reaction, this one. Okay, it is proportional to this. So if you take this like this, so there is a constant of proportionality and it is given by mu mostly, and this is known as coefficient of friction, and that is what can attain a maximum value when this just starts sliding. Okay, and that is known as static friction coefficient. Okay, this is normal reaction, this is F. So most of the things that I am discussing, you already know that, but just to recapitulate things and getting things in place the way I want it, I am covering them. Okay, so what will happen? Some more physics inside. So there is an angle here that is associated here. Okay, what is that? So gradually as you increase this, this kept on increasing. Okay, so this keeps increasing, but this remains constant. That means what happens? If you see this force and this kept on increasing, this one increases. That means this angle initially was zero. As this increases, it goes something like this and finally to a value. This is an exaggerated figure, but this angle keeps on increasing, which is maximum. So maximum is the one when F is maximum, and that is when mu s is there. Okay, static friction is there, and that is the maximum angle. Okay, so we'll talk about this angle later, but for the time being, mu Fs is equal to mu s times n is something that we have obtained. Okay, next is for equilibrium. Till here, friction force increased, it reached to a maximum value. After that, suddenly it has dropped. When that had happened, as soon as the object started moving, that is in motion, okay, and then Fk dropped significantly, and that is known as the kinetic friction, okay, that is a kinetic friction. And then mu k, the constant of proportionality there, is called kinetic friction coefficient or coefficient of kinetic friction. So these are the two terms that we dealt just now. Mu s is coefficient of static friction. Next is mu k, that is coefficient of kinetic friction. Got it? And Fs and Fk are static and kinetic friction respectively. Friction is what? It is proportional to n and depends on surfaces. Surfaces, their materials, okay? Yes, independent of contact area. This is again a huge assumption, or it is validated also. So, irrespective of the area which is there in contact, okay, friction doesn't depend on that, okay? It only depends, yes? It should, the way we have assumed, the first assumption that we made, it is due to intermolecular forces. You may say that yes, because number of molecules now in contact is more, if you increase area, this should increase, but physically it doesn't happen. It has been experimented and it has found out. That is why this is still in, yes. Yes, what weight is about that? We'll come back to that. So, what somebody has asked just now, why it should be independent of area of contact, that is why it is still an assumption. It is an assumption, it is not yet validated. There are many experiments to do that. Okay, so one of the experiments, they found out that it doesn't depend on area of contact. You can try this at home also. You try increasing the area of contact, it is hardly increasing, okay? So, but yes, you should also have something which is not too much irregular in surface. If the surfaces are irregular, increasing the contact area will definitely increase the frictional force also. So, there are two mechanisms through which it can be studied. One of them which says due to contact area and irregular surfaces, that is what we have considered also. And through experiment, it has found that it is independent of area of contact, okay? There are many mechanisms behind, maybe studied in material science and others, okay? So, yes. Yes. Yes, yes, definitely. As long as weight of both is same, you will see a same frictional force. Yes, same material. It should be of same material of different sizes. Doesn't matter. As long as both of them are having same weight, it will see a same frictional force. Okay. You will see a same frictional force. You have an experiment in engineering mechanics lab out here that does this experiment, and we can validate this.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, so when we say that we are taking that
it is on a surface which is in contact. Yes, it is in between that. Okay. Point is a special case of surface when it is exceptionally small. Point is nothing like a point, okay, which is dimensionless. In this case, point also has a dimension, only thing it is very, very small as compared to a large area. So, area has got some surface which is in contact, and point has got same area but very, very smaller in dimension. So, point is nothing like a point in this case. Okay, point is something which has got a negligibly small surface of contact, that's it. Okay, so as this tip of a pen, okay, so that area is very very small, but area is area, friction will remain same. Okay, okay, so there are many mechanisms of dry friction. You have already seen a few over here. So one of them says, yes, this is your external load that is acting from the top. W is its own weight, so normal reaction will be sum of both of them. So no friction along this because there is no sliding force which is applied from this direction. This block is not trying to move, so there is no friction. This is one situation of rigid body in contact with a horizontal surface. Another one is, you have this force, external force, not from the top, rather it is at an angle with two components, Px and Py, Px and Py. So it has two components. So what will happen this time? Normal reaction will definitely be what acts from the top. So what is there? Py and W, they act from the top, and N that balances it. So vertical balance, you get this. Okay, how much is the friction force? Because again, it is having no motion. There is no motion. Okay, Px is significantly less than static frictional force, Fs, not F. Okay, so as long as it is less than this, whatever is the value, it is not causing any motion. So in this case, frictional force is equal to the applied horizontal force, the force that is trying to slip this block on top of this surface. Then again, F is less than mu s times of n. What is mu s times of n? It is basically static friction. Okay, so force, frictional force is less than static friction. So these things are quite obvious. We will move little faster now. So again, you have four motion, which is impending motion. It is just about to slip. It has reached to a point when it is about to slip. This is known as motion impending. Okay, in that case, Px becomes equal to, Px becomes exactly equal to the static friction. Okay, static frictional force. And vertical is same, Py plus W, that is the normal reaction, that remains the same. Okay, and Fs is equal to mu s. So these equations, they hold true over here. Okay, everything is again in a balanced state, and you can form a force triangle. Okay, using all these forces, you can definitely create force triangle. Okay, so this is motion impending. Now their final situation is, now this inclination has further dropped. Okay, it was initially like this, now it is more inclined. Okay, from this. Okay, so now you have more of this component Px, Py has reduced also. So yes, there is a time this remains as it was, Py definitely has decreased. Okay, this time, now that it is in motion. So if it is in motion, Fk is the kinetic friction. Fk is equal to mu k into normal reaction. So that is what you already know also. So that is what is mu k. So F is less than frictional kinetic friction force is less than Px force. In that case, Px exceeds what is required to let it in same place or in uniform motion. This case, what will happen? This will accelerate. This will accelerate because it is less than this. Okay, accelerate with some acceleration. So this is not in equilibrium. Motion do happen. So these are the four situations when two bodies are in contact and try to move. Okay. So this, I hope you all already know. We'll go a little ahead further. We'll try to define few more things. Okay, so this was the first scenario, no motion, Px is equal to 0. This was the second one, Now, looking at further by an angle point of view, what is that called? We have defined earlier this theta s, angle of static friction. What is that? As you know, as you can refer here also, earlier figure. So, what actually happened? What actually happened? You have a force, that is friction force. You also have a normal force. That effectively these two forces will create a resultant force that is trying to balance out the external forces, right? That is trying to balance out the external force. So, if you look at this angle, so there exists an angle. This angle is known as angle of friction. So, in case of a limiting condition, when friction force is maximum, so that is known as a static friction angle, okay, angle of static friction. Got it? So, what is that? It is the resultant force arising out of frictional force and normal reaction. Okay, so these two, resultant of these two is this, and that has an inclination with the normal direction, and that is given by psi. Okay, and in case of limiting condition, when friction is equal to friction static, in that case it is equal to psi s. Okay, and again there is no motion. So, this is another thing, and in case of this is motion impending. When this becomes equal to this, it is not less than this, it is equal to this. Last case is when it has overshooted, system is already, this block is already in motion. Okay, in this case, what will happen? You have again a friction angle, but this time this angle is equal to kinetic friction angle or angle of kinetic friction. Okay, again it is the resultant of n and the friction force that is coming here. So, these are some small extension of the definition that is known as angle of static friction, angle of kinetic friction, or simply angle of friction. In case of static, it will be static friction. In case of motion, it will be kinetic friction. Okay, so, we will simply call it as angle of friction, and that is due to resultant of F and N. Okay. Okay. So, now this cone, this effectively, as long as it is planar, whole of all the forces, they are coplanar. They lie on a plane, but forces can happen from multiple directions. Let me have some object. Okay. This object can be acted upon by forces from multiple directions. Okay. Forces can act from multiple direction. In that case, you see what R, this R basically from this N, this forms a cone like structure. Okay. If you, this force and this R is always on a plane. If external force P and R, they always lie on a plane, and that plane can rotate about this vertical axis. Got it? This axis. Okay. So, the way P, the projection of P rotates about, that means Px rotates about this vertical axis like this, R will keep rotating like this. So, overall it makes a cone, and that is known as cone of static friction. In case of static, in case of kinetic, it will have cone of kinetic friction. So, this is a three-dimensional view of exactly something that you have seen so far on a plane. Now, we do not stick ourselves to all the forces, they lie on a plane. Okay, so, this is just an extension of that, nothing very special. Yes. Distribute hoga nahi. So, if you apply from here, it is here. If you apply from here, it is here. So, effectively, okay. So, these are the different situations when forces are there. Okay. It is not all on a sudden all of them are present. Okay. So all the forces are not present. This is just the cone within which this force should lie. Okay. So this reaction force will lie within this area. Okay. This two cone in between that conical surface, your R will always lie within that volume. Okay. So this is just a physical understanding how it should look like in 3D. But yes, at a time only a plane will exist that is corresponding to P and R. Okay. Yes, yes, yeah, definitely. That is an outcome of that. You can say that. Okay. Okay. So this is tan mu s. It is a resultant of F and S because R is resultant of F and N. So tan mu s is simply two forces which are in situation when both are there. So you can simply write psi s should be equal to F s by N. So F s is equal to mu s. So it will be this by this. So tan s is equal to tan psi s should be equal to mu s. So this is one derivation. Similarly, in case of kinetic friction, you can write this. So hope these two are quite clear. So we'll move ahead without going much something that we already know. Okay, so angle of repose, hope you remember this as well. So this is a situation when this block is at 0 degree. I am just showing it with an angle so that I can show it at least. So this angle is 0 degree or nearly equal to 0 degree. Okay, so that is 0 degree. This is aligned with this. You know that both should be collinear. Okay, and there is no friction. Next, it has in the surface is now inclined at an angle theta from the horizontal. Theta from the horizontal. This time, what has happened? Again, W should equate to R. This time, not equate to N, which is N is always perpendicular to the surface. You know that already by our assumption that we have made, and it is like that. So N is always perpendicular to this surface. Okay, so this is time N is not aligned to W. So what is aligned to W? Because it is not in motion, there has to be a force which balances out W because it is not in motion vertically. So what is that? It is exactly R which balances this. It is R which balances this. Okay, so this time you have two components. You have two components. So what are they? First is, what is R? R, where is it? How it has or initiated? It has actually, it is a resultant of frictional force. Friction force is balancing what? It is balancing the surface component, that is W sine theta component of this load, right? And how much is N? N is balancing out what? Cosine component. This component is balanced out by N. So this is your N. So N is balancing W cos theta. Okay. W sin theta is balanced out by F. Okay. Now you know W sin theta is F, N is W cos theta. Okay. So resultant of that is R. So you can quickly write what? You can relate them, no? So tan theta should be equal to F by N. Tan theta should be equal to F by N. Okay. So again, we'll write it further. So in case of motion impending means this angle has further increased and there is a situation when it is just about to slide. That is the maximum friction that this block can see along this surface. So this is frictional force that is due to the static friction. Okay, and this is known as angle of repose. Angle of repose. In this case, so you know tan theta from here, what you got tan theta is equal to f by n, and this is also equal to, this was also is equal to 10 of psi, that is the angle of friction, that if you know that. Okay, so over here what has happened, theta is just about to slip. In this case, f became fs, theta became 10 theta, that is angle of repose, and psi became psi s. Okay, everything else is similar to this. So both of them are similar situation, only it has got a special significance that psi is now the maximum angle that can be between n and r. Okay, normal reaction and the resultant. Okay, so it is just a maximum case when motion impending that happens. Otherwise, next is a case when it is under kinetic friction. Okay, again triangles are similar. In this case, you don't have anything to balance out this motion. This is, you see, this is what R balances out W. Okay, both are collinear also. Okay, that is the reason there is no motion along vertical direction. But in this case, block finally comes down vertically as well as horizontally, both direction it is moving. So if it is moving, this need not to be collinear with this. This is not collinear with this. And again, this angle has further increased. In this case, R is not aligned to W. You can see that. And this is the case of kinetic friction while the body is in motion. R is not vertical. You should visualize this physically. Okay. If at all R balances out W, there will be no vertical motion. Okay. As long as it is in surfaces are in contact, if there is no vertical motion, it has also no horizontal motion. Okay. That means body is at rest. That means this condition. Okay, so this has to be different. So how it is happening? Again, you have friction force, that is kinetic friction, that is acting in this direction. Again, you will have a balanced triangle or not. There won't be any balanced triangle. Why? Because body is in motion now. So it is no more in equilibrium. Okay, so these are the four cases. So these are, this is very important definition. When it is impending motion, it is known as angle of friction, is known as angle of repose. These terms were very known to you all earlier also, but we have gone through this. So let us now do one small problem. Okay, what it says, a movable bracket, a zone placed at any height, diameter of the pipe, situation is in front of you, so diameter is given as 75 mm. Okay, if coefficient of static friction between the pipe and this is given, coefficient of static friction is given. Okay, determine the maximum distance x. This distance is asked where you can place W. This W can be placed so that there is no motion. Okay, if you go further off, what can happen? There is a limiting situation. There is an optimum situation. What is happening actually? There are two rings, top ring and the bottom ring, and the bottom ring. So if there is a pipe which is passing through this, what is happening actually, if this is something like this, so this is trying to move it in a, rotate like this, is it not, in a clockwise manner. So now what can happen, this surface will be in contact. I assume it is almost of same diameter, but if it is tight fit, it won't slide anyway. I assume it is sliding, so there has to be a clearance. Maybe a micro clearance or a nano clearance, how does it matter? So effectively there will be a friction in this surface because it is trying to rotate like this. So this surface will assume there is friction, and this surface which is in friction, because this hanger or this frame is trying to rotate like this. So this point and this point is in contact, where you can see friction, okay, and friction is in vertical direction, okay. So now higher is this torque, higher is this normal reaction, is it correct? Because it is not rotating, because it is not rotating, the normal reactions over here and here, for the time being let us both be different, okay. So these two is creating what? These two normal reactions are creating a moment, and that is balanced out by the moment which is created by WD about this rotating axis, okay. So that is balanced out, that is why it is not rotating. So if it is not rotating, there has to have some value over here, okay. So that is the physical situation that you can assume now, and these are the surfaces where friction will be there, okay. So this is what happens if it goes too much farther off. If this weight W goes too much far away, you will see more amount of moment that will come. So that will generate more amount of normal reactions and more friction. That means if it goes farther away, there is less possibility that it can slip. Can you get this? Very good, very good. So if at all it comes closer to this, weight comes here and finally comes here, so it will have tendency to slip. That is why this question is asked, that is the minimum distance from x. So it has to come closer, 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 exactly the situation when it will start slipping. It will start slipping, and that is the place when static friction will come into picture. Why static? Because it is about to slip. It is about to slip means motion impending will be there. So this is the situation. This is what that should happen in your brain, okay, before you start processing this, okay. So now, so this is the point where normal reaction is there, NB and NA both are different, okay. Friction at A and friction at B is there, okay. So I have assumed it different. Let us see what it comes out to be, okay. So two frictional forces, because NA and NB is different, friction forces will be different, because it doesn't depend on surfaces, rather it depends only on the normal reaction you have seen just now. So both the friction forces will be different. Where it acts over here and here, not on the same side of the tube, okay. So this diameter is given 75, height is given as distance between NA and NB, perpendicular distance is 150 mm. X, it will turn out to be, I don't know if it will or not. So how much is X from this? I have calculated it before. 75 by 2, it comes out to be 37.5. that is why it is X minus this. So why I have done it? Because you know I want to create equilibrium of moment and forces, okay. That is why I have pre-calculated this. So it is this distance which is from here to here is X minus this radii from here to here, okay. So that is there. Hope you understood this figure. We'll move ahead. So this was the situation, okay. So friction at A is equal to mu s into Na, and that is given by mu s is already given, Na. Same next equation. So two equations we have formed immediately. So this is quite trivial. You already could do it. Now for equilibrium, Fx is equal to 0. There is no motion along horizontal direction. So there is no horizontal forces. So that makes NB and NA, which are the only horizontal forces, they are directing opposite to each other. Both should be same. Both should be same. That means NB is equal to NA. So what does it mean again? That means FB is also equal to FA. Is it not? because coefficient of friction is same, Na comes out to be Nb, that means Fa is also equal to Fb. Okay. So anyway, so both the frictional forces that are acting is balancing this vertical downward force. There is no other vertical force. So that means Fa plus Fb should equate to W. So these are the few things. By substitution, if I substitute this Fa and Fb to this, what you should get? Yes, exactly. So 0.5 Na is equal to W, Na is equal to 2W. So these are quite okay. Taking moment about B. Now I have taken moment about any one of them could be done. So I have safely taken it at about B. So what all forces that will be visible? All of them. Okay. So this time I have already evaluated Na here. So Na into 150, that is this distance, Fa into 75, this distance, W into x minus this distance. So hope this is quite okay. Clockwise and counterclockwise makes the sign positive and negative. Okay, now solving this will give me what? Immediately everything was known, so it gives me x as 300 mm. So you see, this is independent of W. This is very good thing, right? So irrespective of W, this distance is fixed. This is an interesting result actually. So result is coming independent of W. If you put 5 kg, still the distance should be same. Okay. So this is an interesting result. Okay. So anyway, so I think we'll end here because of time limits. So we'll definitely proceed further in the next lecture. Okay. Let us start with this numerical. What it says, a 6 meter long ladder, a 6 meter long ladder that is supported at this end and this end at the corner of a room. Okay. So mass of that is given, 18 kg mass of that ladder is given. Okay. And center of gravity is 2.4 meter from bottom. It is not exactly at the center. You see, if this is of 6 meter, center is something over here, that is 3 meters. But actually it is not. The mass is at 2.4 meter from bottom. So you should understand, sometimes in exam, you won't be given this figure to visualize. Okay. So anyway, so you start drawing things. Start doing things, you will solve it. Okay. Don't sit and just think. Okay. The ladder is placed against vertical wall so that it makes an angle 60 degree with the ground. How far up the ladder can a 72 kg man climb? A man who is of 72 kg, how far he can climb? That he is on the verge of slipping. Not he is on the verge of slipping, rather this ladder will start to slip. Okay. So angle of friction at all contact surfaces is 15 degree. Angle of friction is 15 degree. That means psi s, static friction, is 15 degree because it is not slipping, it is about to slip. Psi s is 15 degree. That means what is given? Mu s is given. Very good. So mu is equal to psi s should be equal to tan of 15 degree. So mu s is given. Okay. Or just simply mu is given. So that is something which can be quickly done. Now, amount of friction at contact surfaces. You start writing whatever you can write. Okay. Just write what you can write. Okay. I tell you, you will immediately get some combinations. Okay, don't think how this will be solved, how that will be done. It is more of a mathematics once you write all the equation. Okay, so just write the equation, you can do mathematics better. Okay, so friction force at A will be this, quite clear, Na times of this, similarly this. Written down another two equation. Force vertical should be equal to 0. All the vertical forces should be equal to 0. So there are no other forces. This and this, 72 kg. The man, he weighs 72 kgs and the ladder itself is 18 kgs. So this is there. Okay. So Na is equal to this plus this comes out to be 90. Okay, 90. Okay. So 90. So Na will be equal to 90 minus Nb. I have simply substituted this one to this. I got this. Similarly, equating the horizontal forces, that should also equate to 0. So how many horizontal forces are there first of all? Only two. Friction force over here and Nb which is here. So both should equate. Okay. So now, yes. Yes. Actually, what happened now, I have taken all the weights as kg itself. As kg itself, you can safely convert it to Newton. Yes, that should have been done. Yes. It should have been, because it is given mass over here, it should be converted to Newton. Okay, so hopefully I can write it safely as Newton. So let me allow this to write it now. Okay. So anyway, so I assume everything is in Newton. Sorry for this mistake. I'll correct it. Don't worry. So now these two are in Newton. So anyway, so now horizontal forces. Okay. So now the horizontal forces. Now I got a cross relation between these two equations at least. Okay. So now Na tan 15 degree is equal to Nb. So there is a relation between Na and Nb. Relation between Na and Nb. Two relations I have obtained already. Solving that, I will quickly get Na and Nb. On simplification, I can quickly get it as 22.5 Newton. So hope this is clear. Two equations, two unknowns. They are solved. All kgs should be Newton. Okay, again friction force. Friction force is Nb tan 15 degree. From here I have taken. Okay. So again it is 6.03 Newton. Friction force at B is done. Now for equilibrium. For equilibrium, now Ma should equate to 0. Moment about any point should be equal to 0. I have taken it safely about this point. Because all the forces, their distances are already known. Angle is known, distance is known. Okay, this distance is required to be done. This is known, these forces are known. Okay, so everything is known. Only thing that will remain, that is unknown, is x, but this value is known already. Okay, so only unknown that is there, that will appear in this moment balance equation. Clockwise moment should be equal to counterclockwise moment. And that only unknown is hiding here, that can be extracted to be 3.15 meter. So you see, this is done. But yes, you see, even you have taken it in kg, same value will come. Why? Because you know g is getting cancelled out in both sides of this equation, is it not? So even with kg, okay, you will not see any change in the final result. Okay, so you can safely take it, but this, because Newton, some distance is asked, it is safe to play with. If you would have asked, somebody have asked you any weight which can be placed at this distance, distance is given, weight is asked, you have to answer it in Newton. Okay, but because distance is asked now, I played it that way. Okay, but yes, be careful. Newton should have been done to be safe, to be on the safe side. Over here it got cancelled out and finally you got the correct answer. Okay, that's all. That's all for today. I hope that is done. So next class we'll do some wedges, your favorite pizzas. Okay, we'll talk about wedges. That's all. Thank you.